Good Shepherd. The King of Love, my Shepherd is. Oh, don't we know that? Throughout Easter, we hear in the epistle what it means to be a follower of the risen Christ. And today, we concentrate on two things: suffering, wrongful suffering, and sacrifice. Both are part and parcel with our calling as followers of Jesus. In the epistle, we hear these powerful words: "This is thankworthy, if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully. When you do well and suffer for it, you take it patiently. This is acceptable with God. For hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, as an example, that we should follow his steps." That's why we also suffer wrongfully. We are followers of Christ Jesus, and completely his. That means we do what he has done, what he calls us to do. In fact, have you ever had a son or a daughter or a young person who was a spitting image, a perfect likeness of one of their parents? I've seen a couple of those. Likewise, you and I, as followers of Christ, we are to be a mirror image of Christ, living his life in our life, doing what he's done, not doing what he cautions us not to do. As St. Peter said, as Christ suffered, we too will suffer. Why? For his sake. Now, have we suffered for the sake of the gospel? These are questions that we have to systematically ask ourselves in the quietness of our own life. Have we suffered for his sake? Have we been persecuted, put down, laughed at, chided? It doesn't matter what it is. Do we endure suffering because of the faith? If we do, congratulations, you're blessed. It's a fabulous thing that you are attempting to do. So that's suffering wrongfully. Now about this other thing that we prayed about today, about Jesus, and that is sacrifice. Don't you understand? I think we do. Every once in a while we forget the powerful nature of it. But during Easter, we are faced time and again with the most powerful symbol of the church. What is that? It's the crucifix. On the one hand, the crucifix is a reminder of man's destruction of all that is good and holy. And yet on the other hand, it is the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the offering of the Paschal Lamb for our sins. And so, suffering wrongfully and sacrifice is who we are. It is the glory of the apostles. It is the crown of the martyrs. It is the sanctification of the saints, the vehicle through which you and I and all who follow our Lord are given things eternal. Let me give you another example of what sacrifice is all about. It's the altar flowers. You see those. Now they're cut flowers. They're always cut flowers, and they symbolize week in and week out of the sacrificial life to which you and I are called in Christ. There are but two events that give us the opportunity to put the live flowers on the altar. That is Christmas, poinsettias, and Easter, the lilies. Easter and Christmas signal a transcendence of time in our life, a permanence beyond the normal day-to-day activities that we have here in this world. And yet, normally, cut flowers, if we allow it to remind us, signal sacrifice, just like we are called to lead a sacrificial life. Now, today's lesson in the evening prayer is a very powerful one. I hope you read it. It's the second lesson in evening prayer. And it tells of an appearance of the risen Christ had to his with his disciples. And he spent some time with them, and he asked Peter three times. He said, "Peter, do you love me?" And Peter says, "Yes, Lord, I love you." The second time, "Peter, do you love me?" And he said, "Yes, Lord, I love you." Second time, our Lord said, "Feed my lambs. Feed my lambs." The third time, "Peter, do you love me?" And Peter gets upset and he says, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." And he said, "Feed my sheep." And then he looked at Peter and he said something very powerful and profound. He said, "I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest go. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldst not." And then spake Jesus, signifying but what death Peter should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he looked at Peter and said, "Follow me." He says that to us also. Our calling is a very simple one: to embrace wholeheartedly the faith of Christ crucified, knowing that no matter where we must walk in life, he is with us. "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me." That's the powerful message of the gospel. And one last thing, I want you to hear this, and it comes from Bishop Frank Wilson's book called Faith in Practice. I think some of you have read that, and we're going to be doing a study during Trinity about that also. At the end of his book, he summed it up not only for his book's teachings, but also he sums it up for us. This is what he says at the end of that book, Faith in Practice. "We cannot afford to spend this short life on matters non-essential. Beware of spiritual compromise. A reduced Christ can never bring God's kingdom to pass. Don't look for the easiest Christian way. Look for the greatest Christian good, even if it costs you more. Magnify your Christian privileges. Exalt Christ. Be loyal to his church. Christ is your one master. Tolerate no other."